This being a four-rotor engine requires a special custom-made engine stand, which I have that twin turbo four-rotor sitting on. So we'll have to make some adaptations because of the nature of the engine. Each side plate has to be held both at the bottom and at the top so that there's no flexing. It'll probably take 2 days to actually, day and a half, 2 days to actually stack the whole rotor, fork it down, and spin it, make sure that everything spins fine. Special consideration has to be taken for the length of that shaft, which is quite long. So the clearances on the bearings also have to change from what you would normally run on a two-rotor engine because, you know, you're dealing with a shaft that's this long versus a shaft that's this long, so the slightest misalignment in the dowel pins, anything can throw this can shift ever so slightly the plates. So in doing so, you must give the shaft some dancing room so that it doesn't bind and prematurely score the bearings during the break-in process. So part of the deal about building an engine of this nature is to actually create some play in the actual stack-up of the motor, and that basically I do it with the tolerance of the stationary gear bearings. I run tighter bearings in the number one, number two, and number three, and looser bearings on one and four to allow the shaft to, you know, have some dancing room. Because of that, obviously you lose some oil pressure, so part of this whole deal is also building an excessive amount of oil pressure. I like to run very high oil pressure anyway, but on an engine of this nature, we really have to make sure that the pump is at its maximum and have enough oil pressure in the motor to make sure that you can dump the excess and not have a situation where, you know, you build up great oil pressure up to about 8,200, 8,300 RPM, and then when you start spinning at 96, 9,800, 10,000, have the oil pressure drop. So we must have enough oil pump, enough oil delivery, and enough clearance, tolerance, so that I can maintain a solid 160, 170 pounds of oil pressure throughout the whole RPM range. We expect to run this motor in excess of 9,600 to 10,000 RPM. So, you know, we need to have the blood as healthy as possible. There's a lot of attention to detail that goes into building a motor like this, where it will last. That's the whole idea. You know, and you can put it together, and you can put it together that it'll run, and if you were to have it in a street car, it will probably run forever. But when you start getting to the RPM ranges where race engines live, all sorts of crazy things can happen. So everything has to be brought to absolute perfection. The balancing is absolutely critical. Each rotor has to be exactly the same, both dynamically and statically. The dynamic balance has to be, well, at least in my world, in my book, has to be within 2 to 3 tenths of a gram.
Are they within that tolerance right now?
Pardon me?
Is that what you've...
Oh, yeah.
What about the overall weight?
Well, you have a front and a rear counterweight, which take into consideration the imbalances created by the rotors. On an engine like this, rotor 1 and rotor 3 act as one mass, rotor 2 and rotor 4 act as another mass. So that's the reason why they have to be exactly the same. And then, you know, once we balance the complete rotating assembly, the actual front and rear counterweights are not quite as critical, but they're still critical. Those I keep below 3/10 of a gram on both ends. The rotors I keep them below 2/10 of a gram. Mazda, when they built the four rotor engines, considered 10 grams to be an acceptable tolerance. But then again, they were very conservative and they were only twisting these engines at about 8,800 RPM. So we're talking about going an extra 1,200 more. Also, they had special rotors. We're using production rotors. They had the J-Spec engine was a purpose-built totally specialized endurance engine. We're taking a production-based 13B, adding extra stationary gears, having a custom ground crankshaft, which are done in New Zealand by Precision Engineering, and they're absolutely fantastic. But nonetheless, you still have to make sure that everything is perfect.
You balance the crankshaft already?
No, the cranks, you can't balance the crank. They are as they are. What you do is you balance the rotating assembly with the weight of the rotors, the seals, and the oil that's inside of them with the front and the rear counters.
Gotcha. When do you expect to get this plate corrected here?
While I'm doing the, now that I've got the real plate that was supplied and it's not going to work because it interferes with the structural mechanism of tying the engine together, now that I have the original one that was supplied, we can go ahead and copy it and add, just like they added ears in the front for the mounting to the tub of the car, do the same thing, add some ears in the back so that we can place the pull rods that come from the tub to the rear suspension, actually to the bottom of the bell housing, to hold the transmission from doing one of these with the chassis. We're gonna have to, this plate is half inch thick, so it's plenty strong. We're gonna introduce some extra material out here so that the push rods can actually be bolted onto the sun plate instead of the rear plate. And that's where we're at. We're moving forward relatively quickly. This is something that would normally take several months to do. We're trying to do it in the better part of about 3 weeks. Here we are. From this stage, once the engine is built and the ratchet system is installed, you go to the dyno, fire it up, make sure there's no oil leaks, feel comfortable with it, run it, break it in, get it up to temperature quite a few times, go through several heat cycles, and when everything is perfect, then we'll start doing some pulls. We'll probably spend about, we'll spend about 6 to 8 hours of break-in time, dyno time. Each hour of dyno time translates to about 4 hours of real time. So we'll spend 2 or 3 days breaking the motor in before we actually start revving it past 6,000 RPM.
What about the final mapping and tuning?
Final mapping and tuning obviously will have to be done on the vehicle with the exact exhaust system that the car is going to run and the exact intake system that the car is going to run. Due to the time restraints that we have right now trying to make this event, even though we asked for the intake and the exhaust, it has not been supplied. Again, they have to make some modifications because the spacing between the J-spec engine and the B-spec engine is totally different. The J-spec engine has two fat intermediate side housings between 1 and 2 and between 3 and 4, not between 2 and 3. Just like the 3-rotor has a fat intermediate housing between 1 and 2. With the production-based Australian style, which is what I like to call them, 4-rotor engines, they're all narrow housings. So the actual architecture of this engine is a little bit narrower than the original J-spec 4-rotor engine, although it's actually a little bit longer end-to-end because of the dry sun system from the production-based 13B, 20B type engines is different from what the J-spec engines had. The J-spec engines had a very narrow front cover with a mechanical dry system to, even though the pump was an integral part of the front cover, it was like an external pump, like a NASCAR style Weber or Peterson, Peterson type of external pump. We're using the largest dry sun pump that Mazda makes currently for the for all the race engines, and that is all in the front, and it's all a self-contained unit, so The actual length of the engine is slightly longer than the original J-spec motor, even though the architecture of the block is shorter. So in that aspect, we're a little bit better off because there's less mechanical stresses on the crankshaft beam that's a little bit shorter. At the same token, the actual physical dimension of the engine is slightly longer than the original J-spec motor. So it's all a compromise, and we have to play with it and make the best of it. Power-wise, we should be able to produce, I'm confident we're going to be able to make a fair amount more power than the original J-spec engines made for many reasons. We run a little bit more compression, much better balance, so the parasitic drag of the engine has been reduced substantially. The intake ports and the slide valve have been opened up to a much larger diameter. We're running 52 millimeters instead of 48 millimeters, which is what was, you know, the standard back in those days when these engines were being run professionally. So all in all, the engine is going to have much better volumetric efficiency than the original J-spec engine. We just got to make sure that structurally the engine is, you know, like a Sherman tank. You know, try to make it as solid and as rigid as possible so that no gremlins appear. Tell me when. All right. The port timing on these engines it's been 30 years of development, ongoing development. We started running these engines back in the early 80s. Spent years developing tune lengths of the exhaust system, port timing, shape, angles, everything that you can imagine. If an improvement was made, we built on it. If suddenly we went backwards, we discarded that change and kept going. The shape of the intake port is such that it's something that, you know, just kept developing and developing and developing. The factory, Mazda factory race rotor housings have not been produced since the early 90s. So anybody that builds a peripheral engine has to make their own peripheral port rotor housings. And that is done by machining it and putting a sleeve, boring it, holding it in place, adding your flanges. We've developed and developed and developed this combination as much as possible. Where we're at today, actually the same basic design was achieved back in 2010, and it worked so well that I haven't done any further development on it. The shape of the intake port, both intake and exhaust, but the shape of the intake port is really, really, really critical. As you can see from the inlet where the intake manifold sits, the shape actually has a funnel at the bottom where the opening point is flat. There's a very simple reason for that. As the apex seal crosses the intake port, if it were round, imagine that's the apex seal. If it were round, it would open the port from a small area to a larger area and a larger area and a larger area. Obviously, that works, but it doesn't promote scavenging. The idea about having a flat bottom is so that when that apex seal crosses the bottom of the intake port, it is sudden. It is a shockwave that is generated. And when the exhaust system is tuned correctly, the quicker you open the port, the more it will scavenge. And the whole idea is to create a vacuum as the exhaust is pulling on the intake through the rotor pocket. You want to create a vacuum in the exhaust system where it actually pulls more mixture than the total sweat volume of the combustion chamber. The idea behind that is to fill up the engine more, increase the volumetric efficiency. And we do that by the shape, the location, the port timing, and, you know, the shape of the bottom of the port, which essentially opens the port at once. It is critical to make maximum power. And again, the size of the runner, the location, the opening point, the closing point, crankshaft degrees, but it's actually rotor degrees, is what gives the tune to the engine. this combination makes maximum power, maximum torque at about 7,800 RPM, and makes excellent power all the way through about 9,800 RPM. Peaks out at about 95, stays flat to about 98, then it begins to taper off. Accommodate different combinations of intake manifolds, also to be able to lean the intake system on the car to better fit the engine compartment, as on race cars we put the engine as far down and as far back as possible. So this allows us to tilt the intake system. A very convenient way of packing. Once they're bored and flanged, basically weld them in place, finish the actual contouring of the intake port to look like this. This is the actual finished piece. And then obviously everything else is finished by hand with high-speed grinder and sandpaper. This housing started life out as a third generation turbo rotor housing. We've already opened the exhaust port slightly to get the correct contoured angles, and now we're finishing up the port, and this is the actual closing port as compared to a stock housing, which would be somewhere around here, somewhere like that. Comparing the port timing on a peripheral motor, it is that much bigger. And the reason why we do it on the mill is to make sure that each and every housing has the exact same port timing. Same thing with the intakes. The intakes are bored, sleeved, flanged. The flanges actually can turn. This is a jig. Tell me when. This is a jig that we made several years back with all the holes to grab the rotor housing using the pins. All position fit, and I have provisions to put the housing in many different angles. Now that we're fully set up, the housing up against the plate, it's been indexed both on X and Y axis. Come in with another pin on top, put it in position. tightened up. The housing is fully secured now. And we can begin our machining operation again. The housing is solid. Finished off the radius, it's finished off by hand, but once we have the opening and closing points, then the final radiuses are basically done by porting it. Same thing as with these little tips with a hand porting tool, a hand grinder, finish the port. Because you're going to be increasing the bore of the bearing, and you're going to be taking an X amount, about 70 thousandths of an inch, to increase the oil groove, to basically increase the hydraulic pressure. Hydraulics is a simple function of pressure times area. If you have, for rough numbers, 100 pounds of pressure, and you have an area of 1, you essentially have 100 pounds per square inch. But if you can increase that area to, say, for round numbers, 5, then 100 times 5, now you have 500 pounds per square inch. So the more you increase that groove within the limitations of the bearing to hold more reserve of oil, in essence, you're increasing, for the same pressure, you're increasing the pounds per square inch of the oil film that can sustain the weight of the rotor at float, so that it doesn't, even if there's an overrev, to prevent the rotor bearing from touching the crankshaft. Stopping just short of the 70 thousandths mark. Here I'm stopping at about 69, and I'm going to go do the last 1 thousandth by hand. Let it spin a few revolutions like that. Now you can see the shining width of the groove, and we'll bring it right back to our stop, which is right there, and I'll show zero on my indicator, and go another 7 to 10 thousandths deeper. We went 7, At this point, I'm gonna go 19,000 steep so far. Automatic feed from 0 to 70. We'll repeat this process until I've gone 70 thousandths of an inch deep. It's always going to chatter a little bit when you get to both edges of the cut, because this cutter has been cut at a 37 degree angle on either side of the center line, like this. The reason is so that the groove is conical as it comes in to give it more strength. So as you go deeper, it's actually cutting wider ever so slightly. There will also leave a little tiny burr at the very end, which you have to take out by hand with some emery cloth and spinning it very gradually.
In doing the clearancing work and bearing work and oil grooves and anything that has to do with a rotor function, the chuck and the machine has to be dead accurate, perfectly centered. I got a Mazda dowel, which is one of the straightest pieces you can get your hands on, and just to use it as a centering device, and grabbed it. And as you can see, the machine is dead accurate. The difference between that side, which has already been clearanced, machine, and the virgin side, which has yet to be touched. This is going to be brought down 5/1000 of an inch. Each side gets brought down 5/1000 of an inch, and then we go ahead and measure all three apexes of the rotor to make sure that both rotors are exactly the same width. Be able to spin, you know, and live without hurting itself at 9 to 10,000 RPM. Well, the street car spends all its life below, say, 5,000 RPM. So a periodic spin up there is really doesn't hurt the engine. But when you hold it up there constantly, and you get a harmonic vibration for the car and the drivetrain, the flywheel, and everything, plus thermal expansion from, you know, holding it wide open generates more heat. Everything has to. Everything will shift, everything warps a little bit. So you have to build in the clearance in order to, when it does distort, when it does get to elevated temperatures of the block, you know, it's aluminum and steel, so everything expands at a different rate. That block is probably going like this, at different RPMs and a different thermal load. So you have to give it room for it all to play and not hurt itself. Now that we know that it's sticking out, I'm going to bring it to the same height as the wall, and then we'll cut straight across. So I'm going to average this thing out. There's a difference between 2 and 3 thousandths. I'm going to go 2.5 thou on the land, and then we'll just go straight across the whole rotor. Okay, at this point, we've already cut the two high spots. Now I'm going to take a pass straight across the rotor. The first pass will be 2 thousandths of an inch, and then it'll be 1, 1, 1, 1 after that, until we get to the exact dimension that I'm looking for. Some people believe in clearancing the rotor in steps. That brings in way too many variables. And the bottom line is that the gear and the land are the highest spots. When the rotor hits the side housings for whatever reason, lack of lubrication, you know, over rev with lack of lubrication, out of balance, whatever, when that wasted bearing, when that rotor walks and slaps the rear housing or the front housing, it always hits the front or the rear because it tries to climb on the gear. the first thing that gets wiped out is where the gear and the land is at. So those are your highest spots. Those have to be brought down to the same, at least in my opinion, to the same level as the rest of the rotor. We still have to go down another 2.5 thousandths, but the finish is absolutely perfect.
How hot does that have to be to go in there?
400 degrees. Otherwise the heat can destroy the babbitt on the bearing. You want to cool the bearing down immediately.
What's the bearing, aluminum or?
The bearing is made out of copper, aluminum base, copper layer, and then a layer of stuff called babbitt, which is a soft material that is laid on every kind of bearing, and you know, for every kind of engine, and it's packed like a pillow, and compresses, and eventually gets really, really, really hard when it changes color, and that way it provides a very smooth surface for the bearing to float onto the film of oil, so as to prevent any metal-to-metal contact. But when you do this, you only get one crack at it. You gotta act fast. You gotta get it right the first time. Otherwise you trash the bearing and you gotta start with another one. More correction for the same amount of material removal. Okay, now see right now the machine is set at a tolerance level of about 0.4 of a gram, I would say. So I need to bring it down. Whoops, that's the wrong one. And it's wrong tolerance. Yeah, 0.3 of a gram. So I'm gonna bring it down to 0.2, 0.2. That way it'll give me my correct readings.
You have to spin it again?
Oh, of course. Sometimes it's quick, sometimes you can spend 2 days on a rotor, especially if it's lightened to the maximum. Sometimes you end up having to take weight where there's no material and you have to get really creative, get underneath on the backside and the webbing, take the webbing out. It's crazy. Exactly the same spot.
Oh my God. Perfect. Not getting closer than that.
What do they say? Viola or something like that? Bingo?
Voila.
That's it. And you know what, whether those numbers are 0.24 and 0.22 or 18.18 or, you know, even if you're in your 30s, I mean, 2/10 of a gram is just negligible, but I like to get it perfect. And when you get it perfect, it's very satisfying, you know? Very time consuming. That's it. Can't get better than that.